Good morning. As you can see, we look a little different this morning. As we prepare for our Messiah concert this afternoon. So before we get into worship in the Word today, we do have to take care of a little business. We do have a few announcements that we would like you to be aware of, which are in your bulletin as well. So today, after service, for a brief 10 minutes, there will be a town hall meeting downstairs in St. Andrew's. So please, if you have the time, please join us. Lots of upcoming events for this holiday season. Yes, as we said, Messiah this afternoon. Brigade caroling, which will happen next Sunday. So please come and join us. Even if you can't carry a tune, right? Just simply making a joyful noise. So please feel free to join us. And as always, we have our Christmas Eve services. We have our family service at 4 o'clock and then our candlelight service at 9 o'clock on Christmas Eve. So please join us. One more item, if you would take a brief look at your bulletin, you will see that over the next month, there are dates where the traffic patterns in and out of the yard have changed. So please take a look at that just to be aware and to know when you're traveling to and fro. So if you please stand with me for church call and remain standing for the call to worship.
Good morning. And now here are our Advent wreath lighting readings. They will not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. On that day, the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal to the peoples. The nations shall inquire of him, and his dwelling shall be glorious.
We are the followers of the root of Jesse Isaiah spoke of. We are the ones who are now called to stand as a signal to the world, to all creation, that peace is the will of the one who created us. Peace is the knowledge of the Lord that will proclaim from sea to shining sea.
In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near, and bear fruit worthy of repentance."
We light these candles, the candle of joyful hope and the candle of proclaimed peace, in part to remind ourselves that we are a people rising towards God's promise. But we also light them as a sign to the world, an announcement that there are some who hold on to hope and there are some who work the ways of peace. We stand as a sign that Emmanuel is still our fervent prayer.
Please turn to hymn number 245 in your gray hymnals.
Thank you. The first scripture lesson today is written in the 72nd chapter of Psalms, beginning with verse 1. Listen to the word of the Lord. Give the king your justice, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son. May he judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. May the mountains yield prosperity for the people and the hills and righteousness. May he defend the cause of the poor of the people, give deliverance to the needy, and crush the oppressor. May he live while the sun endures, and as long as the moon throughout all generations. May he be like rain that falls on a mown grass, like showers that water the earth. In his days may righteousness flourish and peace abound until the moon is no more. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, who alone does wondrous things. Blessed be his glorious name forever. May his glory fill the whole earth. Amen and amen. The word of the Lord. The second scripture reading is written in the 15th chapter of Romans, beginning with verse 4. Listen to the word of the Lord. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, that together you may, with one voice, glorify the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. I tell you that Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As is written, therefore I will confess among the Gentiles and sing the praises to your name. And again he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let the peoples praise him. And again, Isaiah says, the root of Jesse shall come, the one who raises to rule the Gentiles. In him the Gentiles shall hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord. And please remain seated for our response in song, please.
invite you to please stand in honor of the reading of the gospel. Today's gospel lesson is written in the third chapter of Matthew, beginning with verse 1. Listen to the word of the Lord. In those days, John the Baptist appeared in the wilderness of Judea, proclaiming, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." This is the one of whom the prophet Isaiah spoke when he said, "The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." Now John wore clothes of camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then the people of Jerusalem and all Judea were going out to him and all the region along the Jordan, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit worthy of repentance. Do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our ancestor.' For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and is thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and will gather his wheat into the granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire." The word of the Lord. Thank you. You may be seated.
God is good, and all the time. God is especially good. It is such a beautiful time of the year to see the poinsettias in here. The Flower Guild, the Chapel Guild is at work. Messiah is in progress last night and this afternoon, and so we have different traffic patterns, and yes, we're going to have communion today. Forgiveness will abound. Just listen up for the directions. God is good all the time. Would you pray with me briefly? Lord, I pray in these next few moments that the meditations of all of our hearts and the words of my mouth would be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen and amen. Did you know that you have a superpower? It's true, you do. We're going to test this out. I want you to turn to your neighbor, and the person sitting on your right is going to smile the biggest smile you possibly can and see what happens with the other person. Now, if you're sitting singularly, turn around, make it work. Do Chaplain math here, but test out the superpower. Give them the biggest grin you can and see what happens. You gotta play along. Oh, I hear all sorts of chuckles. Chaps, I can't believe you're making us do these silly things. Well, a few weeks ago, I was home. It was in the evening. And believe it or not, your chaplain can be grumpy. Just truth, especially come the evenings. My battery runs on low. I really need Jesus. I haven't had coffee in a few hours. And I'm home, and I'm moving around and doing things, and my brain is in all different places and all different things, and my brain doesn't work that fast, and things just aren't how they're supposed to be. Chores maybe not have been done. Things are out of place, and I'm just... And I'm grumbling. I'm just moving around the house and barking out orders. Yes, right? True confessions of a chaplain. And eventually, as I'm stomping and moving my way through the house grumpily, my wife, God bless her, is trying to get some schoolwork done for herself. She's at her desk downstairs, and she goes, "Jay, what's wrong? Stop. Okay. Smile. No, I don't want to smile. Smile." And for an awkward 30 seconds, this 47-year-old man, his wife brought to being a boy where I had to smile. And just as I smiled, I could feel my demeanor change. She goes, "Stop it. You have a superpower." Pretty cool, huh? So a couple days later, I'm taking my youngest to school. They go to Naps across the river here. And we're riding in the truck, and I love my kids. They're all good kids, but kids will be kids. And the youngest two's personalities are about as opposite as you can get. And so early in the morning, right, we're getting out the door. Dad's focused on what I got to do next. They're in there, and all of a sudden, you know, the banter starts. I wish I could tell you I could smoothly do things, but my inner grump started coming back out. And then I remembered the words of my wife, that I had a superpower. And so I say to my kids as we're driving along, "Do you know that I have a superpower?" And they're like, "Dad, you're a nerd." And so I give them this grin. Like as big, cheesy, awkward grin as possible while I'm driving. And then in about 30 seconds, it started melting on their faces, and they started laughing. And there was peace in my car, at least for the next 5 minutes, as a superpower worked. Wouldn't it be cool that if our smiles could solve all of the problems? In fact, Mother Teresa said that a smile is the first step towards peace. And I would concur with her after experiencing the superpowers my wife reminded me that we all have. This morning, on the second Sunday of Advent, as we are awaiting the returning King, this is a time where we are confessing and believing that Jesus Christ is coming back, and we're longing for him to come back. O come, Emmanuel. This morning, we're crying out for peace. Except for we have some difficult scriptures. Scripture is always difficult. And thinking about peace this morning, we hear John the Baptist from the wilderness. John was this odd, weird dude who wore camel skin suits and ate locusts and honey. And he's out in the wilderness outside of Jerusalem, outside of the normal practice. And like the prophets of old, he's calling out to everyone, a voice crying in the wilderness, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." Then we also hear interwoven in the Advent readings from Isaiah. I'll read just a couple of verses from Isaiah 10 to remind you. Actually, as it was, Isaiah 11. "A shoot shall come out from the stump of Jesse. A branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest on him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth." And I'm going to skip down a couple of verses. "As a result, the wolf shall live with the lamb. The leopard shall lie down with the kid. The calf and the lion and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them." Peace. Odd peace in the wilderness from Isaiah. So peace is the first word we'll talk about today. Wilderness is the second. And then the one that John proclaimed, repentance, that heavy word, we'll speak about briefly this morning. Peace begins with a smile. Peace is one of those ambiguous words. How do we define it? What does it look like? It usually means that we're all getting along, or in my case, in the morning, it's quiet. Peace means devoid of conflict. But even more so, peace generally means some sort of acceptance, that we're in a good place, that we understand who we are and whose we are. Peace. We all love and long for peace. I mentioned to you that I was grumpy these last couple of weeks. I just confess I've been fighting an inward-outward attitude. Life is good. It's good to be a chaps. I have a great family. I have a great job, but it just has just been one thing after the other. And this last week, I had the opportunity to take my middle child on a field trip to Ford's Theater to watch A Christmas Carol. Unashamed plug. Fantastic show. And I found that as I was excited to go, I loved going to the theater, and I got to spend time with one of my kids, and we sat down there, and the production began, and the Christmas carols began. Something in my soul stirred. I've been living in a wilderness, and I started hearing the songs of the hymns, and one of them in particular, "Hark the herald angels sing," right? And the next line is what caught me. "Peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled." Peace. What does peace really look like? Now, the power of a smile is a wonderful way to begin with peace, but the truth of the matter is that my sons still bicker. Like, there was peace for a few moments in the car. We were all laughing, but their problems, their issues, their challenges, their hurts, their habits, their hang-ups still rear their ugly head. What does it mean to truly have peace on earth? Peace with God and one another. How do we find it? How do we work through our hurts and our habits and our hang-ups? You know, that sin stuff that we all have. How do we find reconciliation without separation? Because truthfully, for me, this is the uncomfortable part. We can find peace in the short term. Usually, as human beings, we do it one of two ways. Sometimes, rarely, do we actually work through the issue. Most of the time, we just kind of smush ourselves together and forget our differences and try to make it work. Or we do the opposite, and we cut ourselves off. We go, "I can be at peace with you as long as I only see you twice a year." Well, I hear some amens of that one. I'm guilty of it too, by the way. Peace. Wilderness is a second word. Wilderness is a place that we find ourselves due to our hurts and habits and hang-ups. Wilderness is that place where life, sustaining life, is challenged and difficult. Finding those basic needs as a human being is scarce in the wilderness. Wilderness is where God's people often found themselves when they rejected going his way. If you think back to Scripture and back to the Old Testament, when Moses led them out of Egypt and into the wilderness where they originally were just going for church, y'all. But because of their stubbornness, they lived 40 years in the wilderness. In the Old Testament passage in Isaiah, we find ourselves in that prophecy of how out of a stump, out of a tree stump, a new branch shall grow, is because Isaiah is prophesizing to God's people who once again were living in a wilderness due to disobedience from their leaders, their authorities. He's promising hope. Wilderness is absent often of peace because it's dangerous and, as I said, devoid of sustaining life. And then we have places of wilderness. Maybe not always dramatic, but as I sat there and watched Ebenezer Scrooge on Ford Theater stage, I was struck by the brilliance of how this one who was monetarily successful and owned all these things, how devoid of life he truly was. And Dickens meant to remind us of that in that tale. How lonely and grumpy and cut off he was from people who loved him. And true meaningful work with the riches that he had accumulated. Our wilderness tends to be like that as well. We may not always see it or admit to it, but there are times where our hurts and our habits and our hang-ups lead us to places that are devoid of life. And it may not look like the desert with Weird John, but it's wilderness nonetheless. And then the third word this morning is repentance. It's a heavy word. It's a word where you may go, "Chaps, it's almost Christmas. Don't use that heavy word." Because repentance means we've done something wrong usually. And I don't know about y'all, I don't like it when I've done something wrong. I felt very silly standing on the stairs as my wife looked up at me and told me to use my superpower because I was being a grumpy person. Repentance. Repentance literally means to go a different way. It means to change your hearts and minds, to turn around. If you're heading in this direction, it's the wrong direction. You go, whoa, that's wrong. I need to go in this direction. And John, crying out in the wilderness, calls God's people, calls us to a season of repentance because the kingdom of God is near. Christmas is coming. Christ is coming back. And John says, before that can happen, we need to change our hearts and minds. Because the way that we are persisting in our hurts, habits, and hang-ups don't lead to life. Stanley Saunders writes that repentance is a perpetual state of readiness to challenge our commonplaces, the myths or the stories we tell ourselves that we live by, which produce not the fruit of repentance, but the practices of alienation that separate us even unto violence at times. In other words, repentance in the kingdom of God is confessing that our way or the ways of the world are not God's ways. Repentance changes our ways, our behavior, so that our lives produce the very habits, the fruit, the kind of behaviors that do truly lead to peace, the ones of love and patience and kindness and gentleness and self-control. So what? Second Sunday of Advent. Church, I find myself proclaiming to you as a people who are truly longing for the kingdom of God to arrive. More than just the stirrings of my heart as I watched the Christmas carol and heard our Christmas songs, more than the joy that Christmas comes is the fact that we proclaim Christ our King is returning. That deep longing for peace, true peace, true reconciliation, the one that sustains our needs so that the wolf can lie down with the lamb. How weird is that? The one that says that no matter how different you and someone else is, God can provide the love and the grace you need to be at peace with one another. We all live in the wilderness. We don't like to admit it. We all need peace. Some of us in our own inner life, we need forgiveness and healing for the things going on that we don't want to deal with. We all have difficult relationships. My two wonderful, wonderful children who are bickering, I know many others in my family that are siblings, that bickering has led to deep hurt and pain, to where 80-year-old men didn't speak to one another. Peace comes when we turn around and we see that Christ is appearing, that the one that can sustain us and show us the way to live, the one that can love us through our hurts, habits, and hang-ups can make a difference in our lives. Amen? Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? This morning, church, in a few moments, we're going to communion, so I don't want to say the words we'll say there. We'll have a chance to speak the truth, but in the stillness of your heart, perhaps you're living in the wilderness this morning, and I want to encourage you that Christ stands in the midst of wilderness and offers true and lasting peace in whatever situation you find. If you will simply confess that the ways that you and I have been going don't work, that we need God's superpower so that we can smile and love and work through our differences. I pray that you would open your hearts and minds to that truth and receive God's grace today. Amen.
Please rise for the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please remain standing for our call to prayer.
The Lord be with you. I invite you, either sitting or kneeling, to join me as we go together to our Lord in prayer. Lord our God, our Father and King, we give thanks to you for your glory, which is made manifest by the strength you give us. Fear withdraws when you are near, hearts no longer despair, joy replaces doubt, for we know it is your hand that holds us and in which we are restored. We anticipate and wait the coming of your Son to us this Advent season. We believe the life-giving message that in love you sent Jesus, your only Son, from the eternal joy and comfort of your right hand to us that we might be saved and that we might enjoy your love. In this we rejoice and we give you thanks. Through our prayers and worship, we prepare the way for the celebration of the coming of your Son. We pray this morning for those throughout our community and our world and in our families and our circle of friends who are burdened by illness, grief, fear, injustice, unrest, and the many other causes of our suffering. May the good news of the gospel bring healing and comfort and hope and peace, all those restorative remedies to our human condition. We also pray a special prayer for all of our midshipmen this morning. This week will begin their final week of classes for this semester. Bless every student that they may possess an extra measure of focus, but also a supernatural power of retention of all that which they have learned as they prepare for final exams. Alleviate all stress and anxiety, but give peace that they may enjoy the fruits of your provision. Forgive us, Lord God, of our transgressions. Help us to be restored, to understand and to feel the love and the restoration of your forgiving love. Grant that this season we may seek and faithfully follow Jesus so that his kingdom might be born again in our lives and throughout the world. And let us make known our prevailing oneness as together we pray as our Lord Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Please join me in praying the midshipman's prayer as printed in your bulletin. Almighty Father, whose way is in the sea, whose paths are in the great waters, whose command is over all and whose love never faileth, let me be aware of thy presence and obedient to thy will. Keep me true to my best self, guarding me against dishonesty in purpose and in deed, and helping me so to live that I can stand unashamed and unafraid before my shipmates, my loved ones, and thee. Protect those in whose love I live. Give me the will to do my best and to accept my share of responsibilities with a strong heart and a cheerful mind. Make me considerate of those entrusted to my leadership and faithful to the duties my country has entrusted in me. Let my uniform remind me daily of the traditions of the service of which I am a part. If I am inclined to doubt, steady my faith. If I am tempted, make me strong to resist. If I should miss the mark, give me courage to try again. Guide me with the light of truth and keep before me the life of him by whose example and help I trust to obtain the answer to my prayer, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated.
Let us now prepare ourselves for the Holy Communion. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and a joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed life unto us. When we turned away from you, when our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity. You made a covenant to be our God. You spoke to us through your prophets who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nations shall not lift up sword against nation and shall study war no more. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be a light to the nations. You have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send empty away. Your Son came among us as a servant to be Emmanuel, God with us. He humbled himself in obedience to your will, and he freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and by spirit. On the night that he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given to you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when supper had ended, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my body of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these mighty acts of Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry and service to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at this heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Due to the change in our setup in the chapel this morning, we're gonna have to do a different traffic pattern. So for those of you
who are sitting near the front, what we ask is that you join us as Chaplain Weatherwax and I will serve from the front, right here under the balcony on your right and your left. And for those of you in the rear, we have some other chapel staff that will be assisting you with communion. Once you have been served, I ask you will come, start, and go to the rear, come around, and once you have been served, please return to your seats using the first aisles on each of your sides. Thank you. Let us be served. Body of Christ.
Please turn to page number 258 in your gray hymnals.
Today, I can't help but be reminded of my own wilderness. My wilderness looks a little different than yours, but we all walk through one, many of them throughout our lifetime. But today, I'm reminded of the promise that we are not alone in that wilderness. That wilderness may be barren, it may be cold, and it may be snowing, and you don't know what to do. But there is always hope. There's always a break in the leaves and the trees. There's always light and warmth. Because the God of the universe is with us every step of the way. So be encouraged today, no matter where you're at, that He is indeed with you. So join me in a blessing today as we leave. Gracious Father, may we today choose to brave the wilderness, that no matter what comes, no matter where we find ourselves, and no matter how hard it is, Lord, that we would keep stepping forward in your name. Bless my friends, my brothers and sisters in this place, in this very moment, in the weeks and the months to come, as we celebrate your birth. May we go forth knowing that we have the victory. Bless us this day as we come and as we go in all that we do. We pray these things in your name today. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Be blessed.